influence. Welcome, friends, readers, listeners, and viewers from across America and around the world. We appreciate you taking the time to join us this evening. I am again joined by Rob Skiba in our ongoing introspection into the Book of Enoch. I do believe we are on chapter 78. Rob, how are you doing today, brother?
I'm doing good, Zen. How are you?
Doing really well. How's it going with the crops and the seedlings and the growth and harvest?
Actually, pretty good, man. There was a couple of rainy days we had, and I just didn't feel like getting out. And so some of the crops that are in the greenhouse and stuff, I didn't bother to water. And like, I went out there the next day, and they were like really like massively growing. I was like, wow, look at that. So I'm thinking maybe I'm overwatering some of them, so I'm kind of changing my watering schedule, and that seems to be helping. So a bit more hopeful than in the past. I saw a funny meme the other day. The only way to get a green thumb is to murder a lot of plants.
Yeah, that's the truth.
Well, I guess I'm on my way then.
Right.
But the few that have survived seem to be doing pretty good. So excited about that. I'd like to thank your listeners as well as mine for those who contributed towards Jeremiah, my son's back procedure. He's doing great.
That's fantastic, man. I'm glad to hear it.
Yeah, he said today he hasn't felt this good in years. So appears everything's working well, and you know the procedure went well. So thank you to everybody that helped make it happen, you know, from the whole Skiba family, because it's been a long ordeal for us, and he's definitely doing well. In fact, he went out and applied for a job recently because he hasn't been able to work much because he couldn't do anything. He was laying around in pain all the time. So, yeah, things are looking up a bit.
Well, that's great. What kind of procedure technique, if you don't mind sharing?
Yeah, we saw first of all, it's his L4 and 5, I think, the lower lumbar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, lumbar.
And sacrum area and I forget what it's called. They're just little things on the side of the spine. It was a train wreck. I mean, there's a whole bunch of damage. He had some sports-related damage and then from years ago, and then he re-injured it about 5 years ago. And it's just been a lot of pain. And the lower discs were practically gone. I mean,
oh wow,
they were like really squished and torn and bulging, and you know, when you look at the x-rays, the ones above it look, you know, nice and puffy, and then there's like these black spaces down below, you know. So you know, we looked at various options and nothing looked good, frankly, and anybody that I knew that's ever had back surgery has regretted it. You know, it may fusion and whatnot may work for a few years, but you're just pushing off more problems later.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, some of the ones, you just want to give them like a steroid shot kind of thing that lasts for a little while and wears off. And
right,
you know, we went to one of those deals, and it was like they were going to charge us a $7,000 facility fee, like,
oh my god,
$7,000 to be in the building for them to give you a $400 shot, you know.
That's ridiculous.
And we're like, yeah, that is ridiculous. So you know, we're feeling pretty hopeless there for a while, and then we saw a video with Joe Rogan interviewing Mel Gibson and Dr. Reardon, who's a guy who's like one of the top guys in stem cell research. Mm-hmm. And it was non-fetal tissue stem cell, so like where they take the person's own bone marrow, and I guess they also do stuff with like umbilical cords from successful deliveries. So all of that sounded really positive, and we looked into it, and turned out that so Mel Gibson had it done for his father first. His guy's like in his late 90s and could barely walk and stuff, and his hips were all jacked up. And anyway, they did some kind of deal in Panama with him, and you know, now he's doing great. And so Mel did some stuff on his shoulder, and Joe Rogan was talking about how he did some stuff. And so we're watching this video, and we're like, man, I'm going to look into this guy. And we did. We looked into him, and it turned out he was here in Dallas. Like,
wow.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
He does stuff in Panama that the FDA forbids for being done here, like stuff that you can't do in the States. You have to go to Panama for. But fortunately, you know, Jeremiah's issue wasn't one of those where we had to go to Panama. So, you know, we found out he was in Dallas. It's like a 20-minute drive or something like that, you know.
Wow.
So,
praise God.
Yeah, we went there, you know, and they quoted it was like over $13,000, which, of course, we didn't have. But we put out a, you know, a help SOS on Facebook, and, you know, the community came through for us and really helped us out. One guy, actually, the guy who sponsored me to do that conference in Amsterdam, he sent me a Bitcoin. And at that time, it was about $8,000 in value, the one Bitcoin. And, I was watching it. It was starting to climb, you know, and I'm watching it. It was like going up 20 bucks, 30 bucks. I'm like, oh, and then I waited, and then it went down like 50 bucks. I'm like, oh, man. So I'm watching it again. It goes going up and going up. I'm like, well, if it gets back to where it was, I'm just going to go ahead, because I had to cash it out for cash, and so that it would, because it takes a few days to clear the bank, and then I had to wait for it to clear the bank so that I have it so that I could pay the doctor with it. So, you know, I had a window of time that I had to cash it. But it was like, I don't know, a couple hours after I cashed it out, it went up like $1,000.
Yeah, it went up to $10,000, and then like, was rejected.
Yeah, it went up even higher after a few more days. I was like, ah! But, you know, we have... We had what we needed, and, you know, he came through for us and basically paid off the balance of what we didn't raise through crowdfunding. So that was a huge, huge blessing. And, yeah, he's doing really good now, so, you know, praise God, and thank you to all the... all the people that helped us.
Yeah, that's amazing. And so the stem cell, they placed it into his back, and that just kind of regenerates the... Wow.
Yeah, they had to do, I think it was five different injections, all into different areas of his spine. And he felt immediate results. Now, I think part of that is inflammation, you know, due to putting a foreign substance in there. And so, you know, we're being cautious at the moment that it's not just, you know, inflammation that has separated the disc and relieved the nerve pressure, and then after the inflammation goes down, it gets worse. We're hoping that that's not going to be the case, because it can take, you know, 3 to 6 months for the stem cells to do their things, you know. In there. But, you know, it's one of those things you struggle, especially with the research and everything that I've been doing, you know, with DNA and stuff like that.
Right.
But, you know, if it was an organ or you know, something going into the bloodstream or whatever, I would be a lot more leery about it. But it's directly into the disc, so whatever's in there is localized just to the disc. And, you know, the stem cells, I guess they're amazing. I mean, like the guy, I don't know how you could do stem cell research and not be a believer. I believe the doctor that dealt with us was a believer, because he's like, you know, I don't know where you are spiritually or anything like that, but, you know, this is a miracle. And he was describing how the cells work, and like the cells themselves, like they have a brain almost.
Right.
You know, it's like they
know what to do.
Yeah, they figure out where they are in the body, first of all, and then they figure out what the problem is, and they reorganize themselves to fix the problem.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when we're babies, you know, we have lots of them, but as we get older, you know, we're not producing as much. But, you know, it's doing its thing, so, and this was the best option without having to do surgery, because it was only like an hour, if that, you know, you just kind of go in there, it's a localized anesthesia, they put the stuff in and goes to work.
Wow, that's amazing. Yeah.
So those who are interested, it's Dr. Reardon. You could probably just do a Google search. I think it's Reardon Medical Institute or something like that. But just Dr. Reardon stem cell, if anybody else out there is interested in looking into it.
Well, that's great. Yeah, and I'm sure, you know, a lot of people have issues, because nobody ever tells you how to lift correctly.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like they teach this in school. And then you see people all the time lifting incorrectly and then harming themselves.
Oh, yeah.
And so there's a lot of people that are, have back problems or discs and that are dealing with pain. And so, but anyways, how's everything else as far as with seed?
Yeah, thank you. We had a follow-up meeting with the production studio. I think it was Tuesday morning. And things are going really well. We are very close to what they call a picture lock. And what that is there's 106 shots in the 8-minute video. And so we've been striving to get to where the camera's locked, where I'm happy with the camera angles and the camera movements, and then happy with the rudimentary animations that we've done so far as a previs. So there's about five shots, I think, five or six shots left for them to tweak, and then we get picture lock. And once we have picture lock, that's where the real fun begins. That's where they go in and start. Right now, none of the characters have hair or anything, so you start adding hair and more detailed textures and start building out the environments and composite backgrounds and all that kind of stuff. So the real work really kicks into high gear once we got picture lock. And then also when we have picture lock, that's when sound design and music will go back in. Because if without a picture lock, you do a lot of work on sound design, but then if there's an edit and you move things around, you got to change all of it. So it's best to wait for picture lock before doing the sound design. And so I'm hoping probably early next week we'll have picture lock, and then everybody goes into high gear.
That's awesome, man. And then you had just done an interview with an individual on your seed production as well. Did you want to mention that?
That was actually from a year ago.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Well, I was just looking at some stuff on YouTube, and it fed into my feed. And I was like, oh, I forgot about it. I told him I was going to mirror it a year ago, and I never did.
Oh, really?
I was like, oh, I should mirror it, because he's a dear friend and mentor. He's the guy who really took me in under his wing when I first came to Texas in 2003. Became like a second father to me here, and he does like business life coaching and stuff like that. He
Sweet.
travels around and helps people, do better in whatever they do. And so yeah, we were talking about the seven spiritual gifts, mercy, teaching, prophecy, all that kind of stuff, encouragement and whatnot, and how they line up with a concept called the Seven Mountain Prophecy that Lauren Cunningham, Bill Bright, and Francis Schaeffer kind of came up with a couple of decades ago, I guess. And basically what that is that there are, they call them mountains, or we might consider spheres of influence, like government, business, entertainment, arts, things of that nature, things that have an influence on our culture. And in the course of doing the spiritual gift test that we had been doing for years, when I stumbled across that seven mountain thing, I was like, well, we got seven mountains and seven gifts. I wonder if they line up. And sure enough, they did. And so
Nice.
came up with a whole curriculum on how to turn your passion into a profession, and how you can be fulfilled in life when you're actually walking in the gifts that God gave you,
Yes.
as your profession. I mean, how fulfilled
Yeah,
can you
what a
be,
blessing that is.
right? How fulfilled can you be if you were actually making a living doing what you were gifted to do,
Right.
as opposed to a mismatch? So
Right.
yeah, I posted that for those who are interested. It's on my YouTube channel. And I just recently got the domain blackthumbgardening.net. I bought the domain, and I'm gonna start a new YouTube channel called Black Thumb Gardening. And the whole idea is, most people start out the same way, like nothing's working. And so my thought is, hey, come learn with me. I'll post stuff. We'll learn from our mistakes and celebrate our victories together. And just putting out little videos. Right now, I put out three or four videos, I think, so far. Just little things that I've figured out that I think are going to work. I mean, I don't know if they are or not, but we'll find out.
Yeah, my son is doing the same as far as starting a kind of a new YouTube channel and to explore with others kind of the whole scenario of learning and the process of urban farming and all that. So, and I think it's very important for people to learn how to grow food and also to have something going on the side to where they're not fully dependent on grocery stores or, yeah, I mean, even if you are just doing herbs or whatever, or just salad, production and not, the full crop cycle or whatever, but to learn the process, I think it's very important. It's like, how many people even know how to start a fire, and that is such an important survival skill as well. And so things of that nature.
You would think that that'd be something to teach us, right?
Right. Yeah,
In
exactly.
school, we learned stuff, so much of the stuff we learned in school are stuff I've never used ever a day in my life,
Right.
and something like teaching us how to grow our own food, you would think that that would be really important, So, now as a result, we're having to learn it for ourselves. But if we're fortunate, I mean, with YouTube and the internet and stuff, there are so many resources out there now. But I'm the guy that, like, I get, a product. I don't read the directions. I just try to figure it out. Like, I'm that guy, It's like the directions tell you how to do it, but I don't know. I'm just like, most guys don't like to ask for directions, right? I'll figure it out. So, but like I said before in previous broadcasts, gardening is definitely not the plug and play, drag and drop life that I'm used to. So I've started to look for other resources. There's a ton of them out there. And, we have Texas Aggies, right? The agricultural school college here. Go figure, right? Texas Aggie. You think they might have something? Well, sure enough, yeah, they've got like everything you can imagine on their website. So what I want to do with Black Thumb Gardening is put a lot of resources out there. I mean, there are some great stuff that I've found. Like, you want to plant cucumbers? Here's everything you need to know about planting cucumbers, like all on one page. How high they get, how many, inches between seeds you should plant them, and what's the best time of the year, what's the best time of soil, what sun, like all, like that's what I need. Like a play by play, point by point, break it down. And it was overwhelming when I was thinking about it because we've got about a dozen different plants that I'm trying to grow. And I said, you know what? I'm just going to take one a day, And like everything I need to know about eggplant, that's my assignment today. Figure that out. And if I don't have it planted in the right place currently, then, I'll move it or accommodate it somehow or whatever. Like when they say that one of the biggest newbie mistakes people make is overcrowding, where you just plant too much too close. And I've already done that. I'm like, oh geez, because when it's a seed and it's a little seedling, and you got this huge bed, right? You're like, oh geez, I should put more in here. But as soon as they start growing, and then you think, oh geez, a watermelon, that geez, that's pretty big. once it finally grows, right? So yeah, I clearly have way too much crowding in one bed where I've got like cantaloupe and watermelon and squash and cucumbers and okra all like in one bed. And I'm like, yeah, this is kind of, okay. By the time we're done with black thumb gardening, the whole thing is going to be turning your black thumb green. If I can do it, you can do it. It's like, look, if this gamoke can figure it out, anybody can. That's kind of the idea behind it.
Yeah, and there's another thing of there's certain crops that should be grown together as
Together,
well
yeah.
that assist each other and keep weeds from coming up and things of that nature. And so yeah, again, it's a full-on learning process, and but something that not only should people enjoy doing it, because I mean, kids, they just want to play in the dirt, and so it fulfills that whole kind of childhood desire, and then learning to just grow food. I mean, there's nothing better. That it's not being sprayed with pesticides or Roundup or things that are harmful, and you can learn to do farming where you don't have to do like the corporate, the large industrial farms where they're using poisons and toxins just to make their crops look good and delectable, but they're have all these pesticides and stuff on them.
Yeah, we were looking into because you do start running into problems with various critters and bugs and things of that nature. And some things are simple, like okay, birds are getting to your stuff. Go to the dollar store and get one of those little pinwheel, windmill looking little things. It's got like looks like a flower, but when the wind blows, it just spins. And so that's right. What I did. Like, you know, I've got a little hanging thing for strawberries so that they grow out of this hanging thing. So it's not actually in the ground. So I just planted, I just put one of those poles in there that has a little flower like windmill on it, and the wind just blows it and kind of keeps stuff away. But other things like neem oil is real good for different types of bugs, and peppermint oil and stuff. So, of course, Sheila's been into the essential oils for like ever. So, it, you know, creating diluted, because you have to dilute it, otherwise it gets,
right.
You can burn the plants.
Vinegar.
Yeah, different things, and you just spray it on the leaves, you know, keep different bugs out, and you don't need all that toxic chemicals. Although, like I came up with this idea for capturing rainwater and posted a video on that last night. So it collects out of your gutter. And I got a real good system. It's got a 50-foot soaker hose that waters like half the garden by itself.
Nice.
But like I wasn't thinking that. Well, yeah, that's asphalt. Or what is it? I think it's asphalt. Whatever it is, the stuff that they use for the tiles, you know, on the roofing.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm like, well, that could be problematic. So right now I'm looking into. They have these inline. Filters for a hose. I don't know, that typically takes out like chlorine and fluoride and stuff like that, so I don't know how well it does for taking out any kind of toxicity that might be coming off of the roof. So you know, I don't know. I mean,
you learn as you go.
It's
right?
Like rainwater's good, but if it's coming off the roof, it may not be good. So you're like, it's always something.
Yeah, always something. But, I mean, at least you're learning and making use of the knowledge as you go.
Well, yeah, you know, and most of the comments that I've seen on the YouTube videos have been very positive. People are like, yeah, we're trying to do it too. Thanks, this is cool.
Right on.
You always got the haters that come in every now and then. It's like,
of course.
You say to yourself, you know, I'm putting out a 2-3-minute video, okay? So, okay, that's not taking up much time here for you. And all I'm trying to do is help you. You know, I'm saying, like, hey, you know, if you're trying to build a raised garden on the cheap, if you've got any extra storage shelves hanging around, here's how you can do it. Hope that helps. And so I'll still get like 5 thumbs down. It's like, what goes through somebody's head? You know, but beyond that, I had somebody saying, you know, the whole world's going to hell, and you know, the mark of the beast is coming out, and you know, you're talking about this, and I'm like, yeah, because I've been talking about the mark of the beast for 10 years.
Right.
You know,
exactly. Yeah.
And I was looking at some videos that I did from like 2012, where I was predicting exactly what's happening right now.
Mm-hmm.
Like I was on the Prophecy Club, ironically enough, and was talking about what if they, in a true Hegelian style, you know, dialectic, they create a pandemic that they just so happen to have the perfect vaccine for, you know, and you know, we're going to have to make some hard choices. I mean, you know, that's 2012.
Here we are. Yeah.
Here we are.
Yep. Yep, crazy.
So, you know, I, you know, shifting gears to Enoch, chapter, I think it was 71, had something, somebody was showing me something. Let's see, 50, 60, 71, maybe it's 71 or 72, where it says Enoch is, the angel is with him, and he says that Enoch was the son of man. And that was one of the reasons they were using to say, see, Enoch's full of it. You know, it's contradicting Scripture because we know who the Son of Man is. It's Yeshua. And it was, let's see, 50, 60, 71. Man, I'll have to probably, we're getting ready to go to break anyway, so I'll see if I can find it during the break.
Yeah, but, afterwards.
But the allegation was that in the Charles translation, he says, you know, he's showing Enoch, this is the Son of Man. And, but in the other translations, it's saying you are the Son of Man. You are that Son of Man.
65. You know, I know that even in Luke that Adam is described as a son of God. But with regard to this particular book and all the other chapters that speak about the elect one and the Son of Man, it's very clear that it is referencing Christ.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
you could take a few of these out of context and say, well, see, But yeah, to your point, when you take all of the passages to talk about the Son of Man, clearly it's not talking about Enoch.
Right. I mean, there's so many that are, it's messianic, you know, and it's in the coming, the second advent. And even though I do believe that Enoch will be one of the two witnesses of Revelation 11, still, he's not going to be Christ who takes the judgment seat and makes everybody come and bow before him. So,
yeah, I just looked it up in the Charles. I'll look it up in Lawrence. But it was 71, verse 13. And the head of days came with Michael and Gabriel, Raphael and Phanuel, thousands and ten thousands of angels without number. And then Charles inserts a little parenthetical. It says, lost passage wherein the Son of Man was described as accompanying the head of days, and Enoch asked one of the angels concerning the Son of Man as to who he was. And then verse 14, and he, i.e. the angel, came to me and greeted me with his voice, saying, this is the Son of Man who is born unto righteousness. And it goes on and describes that Son of Man. But the other translations, like the Lawrence and some of the more modern translations, say that it's you there, and that because Charles didn't want to accept that, Charles changed the text and inserted his own translation. So that goes to some of the points we were talking about, even regarding canonized text. As soon as you get into translation, people can start messing with stuff.
All right, we'll be right back, everybody, and we'll be getting into it.
Hey everyone, it's Chris Chio, founder of Truth Frequency Radio and host of Beyond the Veil. The mainstream media and establishment are running scared right now, and they've prominently featured TruthFrequencyRadio.com as number 89 on the federal government's hit list, also known as the fake news list, which is essentially a list of sites slated for censorship on Facebook, YouTube, Google, and other social media. Now is the time for you to get involved. Share your favorite TFR shows far and wide on forums and social media. Tell your friends and family about your favorite shows. If you're a business owner, get in touch with us to feature your product or service right here on TFR. And if you haven't done so already, become a TFR supporter now and get unlimited commercial-free downloads in high quality.
Visit truthfrequencyradio.com/signup.
Thank you for making TFR the leader in independent and uncensored talk radio. Truth Frequency Radio, your protection from deception.
So, you love talk radio, then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on, 24/7, with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on mobile with any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
If you have hard water, the Limescale not only leaves white spots, it clogs pipes and breaks down appliances, costing you hundreds of dollars in energy and wear. Eliminate Limescale and other water issues like brown staining and bad odors with HydroCare water products available from Wave Home Solutions. Wave's affordable water systems don't use salts or chemicals. You'll love the way your water tastes, smells, and looks. Satisfaction guaranteed. For more information, go to bestwater123.com. That's bestwater123.com.
For 5,000 years, the world was ruled with wooden ships by one man. 242 years ago, a small group of free men crafted a new nation built on liberty and freedom. Global elites have been fighting to destroy this new nation called America ever since. Based on actual events, Charm of Favor tells a true story of how they corrupted the election system. They infiltrated federal agencies and murdered witnesses, judges, and even presidents to keep from being caught. Now, the largest and wealthiest crime syndicate the world has ever known has been drawn out of the shadows. They have killed hundreds of Americans and recently attempted to assassinate half our congressmen. Still, they escape arrest through an almost supernatural charm of favor. Read Charm of Favor and be prepared to open your eyes to what may lie just around the corner. Charm of Favor is available on Amazon and Barnes & Noble.
Real people, real radio.
Initiating the truth frequency.
This is Truth Frequency Radio.
And in those days, there were giants in the land, and the sons of the angels of God looked upon the daughters of men and found them fair, and took of them wives, and their sons became of old Greek men of renown. So they have been mixing with us on a genetic level since the time of Enoch and Ezekiel's will.
Here on Earth, we're intrigued by the sun, moon, and stars, and imagine there's got to be planets like ours. So conceive of a face on the surface of Mars. So in need of a meaning and purpose, we lost. And indeed, they believe that these might be our gods, or that maybe with time we'll do right and evolve and eventually reach what they seek and then solve all the problems of man. But they really don't know that they call it the works of our hands are but just filthy rags. So we travel the lands to dig up our past, time on that.
All right, welcome back, everybody, for a second portion. And if you wanted Rob to comment further on what we were talking about before going to break and
okay.
after doing so, we can move into chapter.
Okay. Yeah, so the Charles translation says this is the Son of Man who is born unto righteousness. And then it goes on to describe, you know, some more about him. In the Lawrence, it says, in the Ancient of Days came with Michael and Gabriel, Raphael and Fenuel, with thousands of myriads, which could not be numbered. Then that angel came to me and with his voice saluted me, saying, thou art the, now he says, the offspring of man, which that makes sense, this translation.
Mm-hmm, right.
Thou art the offspring of, actually Lawrence may solve the problem here. Thou art the offspring of man who art born for righteousness, and righteousness has rested on thee. The righteousness of the Ancient of Days shall not forsake thee. He said, on thee shall he confer peace in the name of the existing world, for whom thence has peace gone forth since the world was created, and thus shall it happen to thee forever and ever. All who shall exist and who shall walk in thy path of righteousness shall not forsake thee forever. With thee shall be their habitations, with thee their lot, nor from thee shall they be separated forever and ever, and thus shall length of days be with the offspring of man. Peace shall go to the righteous, and the path of integrity shall the righteous pursue in the name of the Lord of spirits forever and ever. Now that makes sense, that he was a preacher of righteousness, you know, before mm-hmm. before Noah was, and after Adam was. He was the intermediate that was to pass on that righteousness to Methuselah. So Lawrence may actually solve that problem. I was reading a David Wilbur had a whole article against the Book of Enoch, and using this passage as his primary thesis. Saying, oh, we know, you know, Yeshua is the Son of Man, so therefore, you know, Enoch's a heretical book. So I'm like, what? So I went and looked into it, and sure enough, you know, I did see various scholarship, modern scholarship points out that Charles had made some assumptions. You could see where people would do that, you know, and where his assertion that there's a lost passage, he's like, there's never been anything to substantiate that. That was an assumption that Charles was making. Well, Charles was thinking, well, clearly something must be missing here, so I'll just, you know, say that and then change it from you to, now, son. You know, depending on the language, if it's Aramaic or Hebrew or Greek or Ethiopic or Slavonic or whatever, that would be interesting. You know, if it's Zera, well, that, I mean, yeah, that could be son or seed or offspring. So that might be interesting. But I have another translation by George W. E. Nicholsberg and James C. Vanderkam. And it says a new translation. When was this published? copyright 2004. And in that passage, it says, and I cried with a loud voice with the spirit of power, and I blessed and praised and exalted, and those blessed and went forth from my mouth were acceptable in the sight of the Head of Days. And the Head of Days came with Michael and Raphael and Gabriel and Fenuel and thousands and ten thousands of angels without number. And that angel came to me and greeted me with his voice and said to me, you are that Son of Man. who was born for righteousness, and righteousness dwells in you. And their whole thesis is that the book of Enoch as a pseudepigraphal work, which automatically they make the assumption that it's pseudepigraphal, that
right.
somebody else took the name of Enoch and wrote this, mm-hmm. which is pretty common in modern scholarship, making that claim. There's no the reason they say that, though, is because of modern references to various lands that they assume were not around at the time of Enoch, or they're mentioning various lands like Damascus or what have you, different places that we would assume didn't exist until after the flood. And I think we address that in when we come across those things, is that look, he's seeing the future.
Right.
He's up in heaven. He's seeing all of time at once. I mean, we'll see that in a few chapters from now, where he's got the whole animal apocalypse,
yes.
vision of mm-hmm. all of history from Adam to the millennial reign.
Right.
So talking about our current time as well as time that we have yet to encounter ourselves. And the first part of the book says it's not for this generation, but for a remote future generation that will live in the yes. day of tribulation. So with all that in mind, I'm going, well, why would you say that, Isaiah or some of these other prophets can prophesy about things that wouldn't happen for 500 plus years later? I think it's like 500 years from Isaiah to Yeshua. And so why can you accept that Yeshua is being spoken of in Isaiah 53 500 years later, and not accept that Enoch could be given a prophetic future, far distant, or John for that matter? If we believe that we're headed to the tribulation, I believe we're seeing perhaps the beginning of the peeling of the third seal right now. John wrote that 2,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So if we can believe that other prophets of Scripture could write about things that were not known to them at that time, but, are becoming known to us at our time, like Old Testament stuff that prophesied about New Testament stuff, why couldn't you accept that Enoch could do the same thing and be given specific names?
Exactly. Yes, because God does know the end from the beginning.
Yeah, so I don't
reveals that to the prophets. So.
So, some of these arguments, I'm like, come on, guys. It goes to same thing with the flat Earth thing. Is like, look, 2 + 2 is not the only way to get to 4.
Right.
If you lock yourself into the mentality that's it, that's the only solution to get you to 4, then you run into problems. You have to kind of step back, think outside the box, and say, well, is that the only way to 4? No, it's not the only way to 4. 10 - 6, that get me to 4.
Mm-hmm.
All kinds of stuff like that. So, if the Lawrence translation is correct, then that would actually make sense, that because Ezekiel was called the Son of Man.
Mm-hmm.
So if there are passages in the book of Enoch using the phrase Son of Man to specifically address the prophet, as well as this other character who's been around with the Ancient of Days since the beginning, that long predates Enoch, and that all people will pay homage to, and that all things will be under his feet, and all that stuff, then why would we be okay with Ezekiel being called the Son of Man, but not okay with Enoch being the Son of Man? Interestingly enough, Ezekiel is the other guy who got taken up.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Or no, that was Elijah. Well, he was taken
up.
Yeah,
Elijah.
He was taken up in a vision, but
right.
Still, he saw things. Frankly, I see arguments but people latch on to that and say, oh, see, Enoch's heretical because of this. I'm like, yeah, what if there's another way of looking at it?
mm-hmm, right. And this is one passage, and there's how many?
Enoch,
speaking of the Son of Man, come on.
Yeah, their contention, going back to what I was saying about the pseudepigraphal work, is that they're saying, modern scholarship will say apocryphal literature a lot of times will have a famous name attached to it and be written as a pseudepigraphical work. And so they're saying they want to classify everything in a genre. And I'm going, okay, yeah, we write for a genre today. It's like, okay, I'm writing Seed, which is sci-fi fantasy genre. Other people write romance novels, so that's a romance genre, or film noir, or mystery, or whatever, horror. these guys weren't doing that. They weren't picking a, you know, let's see, I'm going to write in the poetic genre, you know. They were writing whatever they were inspired to write to whomever they were inspired to write to. And so, you know, modern scholars come along and say, well, this is in the genre of blah, blah, blah. And so, therefore, they pigeonhole it into this, mm-hmm. you know, little box, and they want to apply all the, you know, hermeneutics that they understand about that little box to that and, you know, claim to understand it. I'm like, yeah, that's not how it was written.
Right. Yeah, often these early testimonies are written for their children, you know, for their latter generations. Yeah, their offspring.
Yeah. Yeah, so I don't think that's a very good argument. They're saying what it was trying to build up to is that you're reading this epic tale. Almost as they want to write Enoch off almost like the Epic of Gilgamesh, right? And so in the hero's journey, so to speak, you find out that Enoch is that son of man. So, ta-da! That's what the previous 70 chapters were building up to, the big reveal. You know, mm-hmm. I'm like, well, that's if you're assuming this is the authorship was designed for this genre for that purpose. And I don't make that assumption.
No, not at all. And then again, looking at the full context,
yeah,
it's
overall,
clear.
That's where you're cherry picking. If you're just looking at,
right,
you know, they're saying a few chapters leading up to it were the setup for this reveal. Mm-hmm. And if you go by that logic, you can kind of see what they're saying. You're like, yeah. But if we've read stuff back in the 40s, chapter
40s, yeah, 46.
Yeah, that were like, you know, how many times we say on the show, who's that talking about? You know,
right,
Dave
exactly.
Murphy, you know, or everybody else that wants to deny Yeshua is the Messiah.
Right.
Yeah. So, not buying the argument. Sorry, David. David Wilbur.
Yeah, me either. And then I know that, you know, with regard to the overall, the Book of Enoch, there's so much truth revealed within it that you can't find anywhere else. And then you see it quoted so many times in Scripture, even by Yahushua himself, you know, with regard to chapter 15, that the angels don't marry in heaven. I mean, that's a direct quote from the Book of Enoch as well. So,
yeah, I haven't got the Heiser commentary on Enoch yet. Have you?
No.
Mm-mm. Yeah,
I didn't even know you did something on that.
Yeah, we mentioned a few shows back that I had seen. I think.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Kevin Stoll's like, hey, check this out. I need to order that. But there's another one that I have. Dr. Ken Johnson has a book called "Ancient Book of Enoch." Published by Ken Johnson, Ph.D., and he gives some really good commentary in the beginning of it. Some of his commentary I don't agree with, but he's got some really good, you know, stuff backing up, you know, quotes from various so-called church fathers and, you know, people mm-hmm. living in the, you know, few centuries after Christ that were certainly endorsing it as Scripture and then showing the many references, internal references within Scripture that appear to find precedence nowhere else except the Book of Enoch. Like, he's got a little chart here. He says, look at these charts below to see Enoch's doctrines and prophecies and how they line up with Scripture. I'll just give a few for an example. He's got three columns. He's got the column one is biblical phrases quoted from Enoch. Column two is the chapter and verse in Enoch. And then column three is the biblical verse. He says, head and not the tail, Enoch 103:11, Isaiah 9:14, sinners will be weighed in the balances, Enoch 41:1, Daniel 5:27, God is no respecter of persons, Enoch 63:8, Ephesians 6:9, it is better for sinners if they were never born, Enoch 38:2, Mark 14:21, we will be protected under his wings, Enoch 39:7, Psalm 17:8, and it goes on for pages.
Wow, that's,
you know,
so cool.
Just,
yeah.
And I've seen other charts like this that people have done, and you know, there are well over 100 references in Scripture that find no precedence in the internal canonized 66 books or even the 80 extended books.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things that are said that find precedence only in the book of Enoch.
Yeah.
And so they want to say, well, you know, Enoch is only dates to between 400 and 200 BC. I'm like, correction. The oldest known copies of the Book of Enoch date back to, you know, that. And by the way, you got the same problem with most of the other texts. you know, because, I mean, what, this stuff was written on parchment and stuff, so the stuff wears out, so they have to recopy it.
Recopy, yes, and
so
remake it, right.
We have the same problem with all the scrolls that we
exactly,
have.
Exactly, yeah, right.
So what chapter are we picking up on?
78, I believe, in the Charles.
78 in Charles.
So it should be 77 for you, maybe?
Probably 77. Let me scroll back on that. 77. Yeah, okay, because we did that one chapter last week and spent the whole time spent off talking about all kinds of stuff. That's all
right. It was a good show, though.
Yeah, I enjoyed that. That was cool. Well, let's see what happens with this one. Chapter 77 in the Lawrence translation. The names of the sun are these. One, Aries, the other, Tomas. The moon has four names. The first is Esonia, the second, Ebla, the third, Benes, and the fourth, Ere. That's Ebla. Have you ever heard of the Ebla tablets? I think it's called the Ebla tablets. Ebla tablets. I have to look that up. I'm pretty sure there's something called the Ebla tablets. These are the two great luminaries whose orbs are as the orbs of heaven, and the dimensions of both are equal. In the orb of the sun, there is a seventh portion of light, which is added to it from the moon. So the sun's getting light from the moon? By measure, it is put in until a seventh portion of the light of the sun is departed. They set, enter into the western gate circuit by the north, and through the eastern gate go forth over the face of heaven. When the moon rises, it appears in heaven, and the half of the seventh portion of light is all which is in it. In 14 days, the whole of its light is completed. By three quintuplets, light is put into it, until in 15 days, its light is completed. According to the signs of the year, it has three quintuples. The moon has the half of a seventh portion. During its diminution, on the first day its light decreases a 14th part. On the second day it decreases a 13th part. On the third day, 12th part. On the fourth day, an 11th part. On the fifth day, a 10th part. On the sixth day, a 9th part. On the seventh day, it decreases an 8th part. On the eighth day, it decreases a 7th part. On the ninth day, it decreases a 6th part. On the 10th day, it decreases a 5th part. On the 11th day, it decreases a 4th part. On the 12th day, it decreases a 3rd part. On the 13th day, it decreases a 2nd part. On the 14th day, it decreases a half of its 7th part. And on the 15th day, the whole remainder of its light is consumed. On stated months, the moon has 29 days. It also has a period of 28 days. Uriel likewise showed me another regulation when light is poured into the moon, how it is poured into it from the sun. All the time that the moon is in progress, while its light, with its light, it is poured into it in the presence of the sun, until its light is in 14 days completed in heaven. And when it is wholly extinguished, its light is consumed in heaven, and on the first day it is called the new moon. For on that day light is received into it. So that would be justification for the sighted moon, crescent moon,
yes,
being the new moon.
The waxing crescent, yes.
Yeah. It becomes precisely completed on the day that the moon descends into the west while the moon ascends at night, that the sun descends into the west while the moon ascends at night from the east. The moon then rises all the night until the sun rises before it, when the moon disappears in turn before the sun. Where light comes to the moon, there again it decreases until all its light is extinguished and the days of the moon pass away. Then its orb remains solitary without light. During 3 months it affects in 30 days each month its period, and during three more months it affects it in 29 days each. These are the times in which it affects its decrease in its first period and in the first gate, namely in 177 days. And at the time of its going forth, during 3 months, it appears 30 days each, and during three more months, it appears 29 days each. In the night, it appears for each 20 days as the face of a man, and in the day as heaven, for it is nothing else except its light. It is nothing else except its light. It's not dirt.
Right. All right. 78 in the Charles. And the names of the sun are the following: the first, or Jares, and the second, Tomas. And the moon has four names. The first name is Asanya, and the second, Ebla, the third, Benaz, and the fourth, Ere. These are the two great luminaries. Their circumference is like the circumference of the heaven, and the size of the circumference of both is alike. In the circumference of the sun, there are seven portions of light which are added to it more than to the moon. And in definite measures, it is a transferred till the seventh portion of the sun is exhausted. And they set and enter the portals of the west and make their revolution by the north and come forth through their eastern portals on the face of the heaven. And when the moon rises, 1/14th part appears in the heaven. The light becomes full in her. On the 14th day, she accomplishes her light, and 15 parts of light are transferred to her till the 15th day, when her light is accomplished according to the sign of the year, and she becomes 15 parts. And the moon grows by the addition of 14 parts, and in her waning, the moon decreases on the first day to 14 parts of her light, on the second to 13 parts of light, and on the third to 12, on the fourth to 11, on the fifth to 10, on the sixth to 9, on the seventh to 8, on the eighth to 7, on the ninth to 6, and on the 10th to 5, on the 11th to 4, on the 12th to 3, on the 13th to 2, on the 14th to the half of a seventh, and all her remaining light disappears wholly on the 15th. And in certain months, the month has 29 days, and once 28. And Uriel showed me another law, when light is transferred to the moon, and on which side it is transferred to her by the sun. During all the periods during which the moon is growing in her light, she is transferring it to herself. When opposite to growing in her light, she is transferring it to herself. When opposite to the sun, during 14 days, her light is accomplished in the heaven. And when she is illumined throughout, her light is accomplished full in the heaven. And on the first day, she is called the new moon, for on that day, the light rises upon her. She becomes full moon exactly on the day when the sun sets in the west, and from the east she arises at night, and the moon shines the whole night through till the sun rises over against her, and the moon is seen over against the sun. On the side whence the light of the moon comes forth, there again she wanes till all the light vanishes and all the days of the month are at an end, and her circumference is empty, void of light. In 3 months she makes of 30 days, and at her time she makes 3 months of 29 days each, in which she accomplishes her waning in the first period of time. And in the first portal for 177 days, and in the time of her going out, she appears for 3 months of 30 days each, and for 3 months she appears of 29 each. At night she appears like a man for 20 days each time, and by day she appears like the heaven, and there is nothing else in her save her light.
Very cool. A couple things occurred to me as we were listening to, as I was listening to you, and as I was reading it also. Number one, people need to check this out. If you haven't done so already, go look up the YouTube channel Thunderbolts Project. Now, these people are not what we consider biblical cosmologists, but they are, you know, PhD level, you know, highly qualified scientists out there who are in opposition to the standard model of the cosmos. especially in terms of how the luminaries work. And they're all about the electroplasma universe and how, you know, they got PhD scientists on there saying, look, the sun is not what you've been told, you know. And they just describe things very, very differently than what we've all been taught in science class. So, you know, when I look at these guys and I listen to what they're saying and apply it to the biblical cosmology, I'm going, man, these guys are closer to it than anybody that I've seen so far. You know, they're not there yet on that, but something worth looking into. The other thing that occurred to me, let me do a, see if I can do a screen share here from my PowerPoint discussing the what we've talked about a few times before, how the four corners of the earth work. And you got this right away. It took me a while to get this. Like, literally, I just got it just now. like, okay, dude, it took me long enough. Where, you know, it's talking about the sun setting in the west and then going to the north.
Right.
Yeah, if you're thinking about that in terms of a globe, that doesn't make sense. Wait a minute. The sun, and I was doing that, like, literally up until 10 minutes ago, 15 minutes ago, whatever it was, you know, I was still applying old school thinking to what was, and you've been saying it all along, is like, you know, the only way that works is in a circle. And even when you were saying right. that, I wasn't getting it. I'm like, oh, I'm going to break.
Yeah. All right, we'll be right back for a second hour, everyone.
Censorship and regulation is becoming an ever-growing problem in today's modern media. From the mainstream to YouTube and Google, the information you're looking for is buried by official narratives and propaganda. This is why TFR is 100% uncensored, unregulated, and listener-supported. The shows on TFR are not micromanaged by the station, and our hosts are free to speak their minds however they please. As such, the views and opinions expressed on our station are of those who make them. If you happen to hear anything offensive on TFR, please send us an email to toughtitty@tfrlive.com, and we'll be happy to tell you that we really don't give a damn. We stand for freedom of speech and non-censorship. If you also stand for free speech, you can go to tfrlive.com/signup and sign up for a TFR supporter pass and help us in our mission to keep the airwaves uncensored and unregulated. TFR Live. Your uncensored and unregulated protection from deception.
An outline is out. I'm Lisa Lacera, Fox News. Many states have already taken action as cases of COVID-19 ease, but the guidelines for reopening from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention are now out.
Making the case each community is unique, the Centers for Disease Control posted a decision tool to its website listing benchmarks to meet before reopening business, schools, and community centers. Depending on the level of risk of spreading infection, the guidelines still suggest various forms of social distancing, cleaning practices, and regulating how many people are inside a business at any given time. Earlier versions of the document also offered detailed information for churches to restart in-person services. Those recommendations were removed because of concerns inside the administration of dictates to places of worship. Jared Halpern, Fox News.
A government scientist who filed a whistleblower complaint after he says he was demoted for not promoting a drug President Trump was pushing as a treatment for COVID-19 appeared before a House panel today. Dr. Rick Bright slammed the administration's response to the pandemic.
The American healthcare system is being taxed to the limit. Our economy is spiraling downward, and our population is being paralyzed by fear stemming from a lack of a coordinated response and a dearth of accurate, clear communication about the path forward.
President Trump brushed off the complaint, saying he doesn't know Dr. Bright and saying he sounds like a disgruntled employee. The New York Stock Exchange will partially reopen its trading floor later this month with modifications after closing it in late March. The president of the NYSE says a small group of brokers will be on the floor the day after Memorial Day. They'll wear protective masks and follow social distancing guidelines, and they'll need to avoid public transportation to limit potential exposure to the virus. America is listening to Fox News.
You must unite what has been set asunder.
We are TFR. Truth Frequency Radio.
All right, welcome back, everybody. And I did post into the chat rooms the video that we had we talked about on a one of your shows previously about the way that the sun moves and how it is cited in the Book of Enoch as moving from the east to the west and then north and back to the east, which again is a circle. And the only way that you can explain these passages, and there's one here in chapter 71 on the Great Luminary where it says the exact same thing. It says the sun sets in heaven and returning by the north to proceed towards the east is conducted so as to enter by that gate and illuminate the face of heaven. And so you're saying that it just clicked for you?
Yeah, dude, I'm a little slow on the uptake, I think, sometimes. Let me go back to that. Yeah, I mean, you've done diagrams of it. You've explained it. You've been on my show talking about it. You've been on your show talking about it. Here it is right here in verse 5. And they set and enter the portals of the west and make their revolution by the north and come forth through the eastern portals on the face of the heaven. Made no sense to me at all. Like, all the times I've heard you describe it, put it up on the screen, show it, and all of a sudden, you know, the light bulb goes on, bing, oh, now I get it. The only way that works is on a circle, but it only works if you assume a vantage point, and I believe that vantage point is from Israel, for north.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, anywhere else, that doesn't really work. But if and what I have on the screen right now is from my presentation I did in Canada, and I think I've done it at the International Flat Earth Conference also, was how the four corners of the earth work from the vantage point of Israel. When you have from there, because the biblical references to north, south, east, west are from there. You know, a nation will come from the north. Well, north of what? North of Israel. You know. So when we see those reference points going north from Israel, assuming four corners are actual geographic locations upon which an angel can stand, that's why they can't be the cardinal points like on a globe, because there's no geographic location called east. Yes, there is. There is West Point, a military academy, but other than that, there's no geographic location labeled west. You know, there's no place for angels to be standing in Revelation 7:1. And all the other references that I have. So if you assume Israel is your vantage point, north would be a corner on the square within which the circle is inscribed, east, south, west, so forth. So it just clicked on me, like, oh, you said it all along, it's a circle. I'm like, yeah, don't get it. Now I'm like, okay, so from there, from Israel, if I'm watching the sun go to the west, it then makes its circuit to the north.
Yes.
And it comes back around to the east.
Right.
Well, at least I got there. At least I arrived. Better late than never, I guess.
Yeah, well, at least you get it. And I'm now showing a portion from the... I don't know if you can see it. I'm seeing a shared screen.
Let me switch it.
And this is from that short 10-minute video. Zen Garcia plots the course of the sun over the flat earth as cited by Enoch. This is what Enoch is describing, where it moves from the east to the west, then north and back to the east, a circle. And this is how the sun moves over the course of the year. And, you know, as it goes back and forth between the tropics of Capricorn and the tropics of Cancer, creating the year.
This and makes so much more sense to me now. Like, how long? Yeah. How many years has this been?
Like, well, I'm glad that you got it.
Hey, yeah. Ooh, crossed the finish line.
Right, and see that is the, you know, that is the key for unlocking the Book of Enoch. Because unless you apply those motions to the backdrop of the Earth like this, it does not make sense.
No.
But once you understand that Enoch is describing the motions of the sun and the moon in a circle like this, then...
Yeah, there's no way you can make that work on a globe.
No.
Because you'd be like, this is sun goes to the east. Year. Even if you went like the Dr. Sengenis, you know, he believes that the Bible is geocentric and that the sun, moon, and stars move around the Earth and the Earth is stationary. That wouldn't make sense either. You know, the sun goes... Because if the sun is going to around the Earth... to the west, there's no way for it to go north and still and still for the next part of the globe for it to still appear like it's coming from the east.
Yes, exactly.
It'd be coming from the north. And that may solve a problem too, because other people, like, they're trying to say, well, how can this be? And you know, I think that resolves the problem. It's like, no, dude, like, I don't know what his what Sengenis' take is on the Book of Enoch anyway. He may not even recognize it, but regardless, Scripture says that the circle of the Earth says the sun and sun and moon are moving, and it says that the sun moves on its circle, coming out of the chamber like a bridegroom to run a race,
right,
in a circle. This only makes sense like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and Psalms 19, I mean, it fits right in with exactly what is described here. And again, when you look at the Targum version of Ecclesiastes, which we discussed that passage in this particular short 10-minute clip, as I said, people can look it up. Zen Garcia plots the course of the sun over the flat Earth in YouTube, and it's like 10-15 minutes long, and it's an excerpt where we were speaking about how the Targum version of Ecclesiastes 1, verses 5 through 7, they speak about the sun moving north. And whereas in verse 6, that southward motion is attributed to the wind, it's actually in the Targum attributed to the sun, because again, it's moving back and forth between the tropics of Cancer and Capricorn. And it creates the seasons, just as Enoch describes in chapter 71 on the great luminary and the motions, the movements of it as it circles in this manner over the course of the seasons.
Very cool. Somebody in the chat room is like, the Earth isn't flat. That is stupid. Because of topography, mountains, hills, and valleys, the Earth is motionless. Nobody's denying topography. You know, even if you say the Earth is a globe, you'd have to use that same rationale. Well, it's not a ball. It can't be a ball because we have mountains. Duh.
No, that's it. People are so picky.
That is nobody's saying pancake. We all recognize.
Right?
We all in either model. We are recognizing topography. So no, sorry, dude. That's a stupid argument.
Right.
But this makes sense, man. That's really cool. Yeah. Like, I should have got it. You know, what year was it when we did that video?
2015.
15.
Yeah.
5 years. Well, hey, at least I got here.
Maybe. Yeah, at least you got it now.
All right, so back to the narrative.
The text.
It is interesting talking about the sun. I meant to look up the Ebla tablets. Maybe we can check that out too. But it was saying the sun is receiving something here. Where was it? The sun is receiving a seventh part or something. You remember?
Mm-hmm. From the moon, right?
Yeah, so, you know, that's bizarre, right? I mean, if we think, there's nothing in the scripture that says the earth is a reflective rock, dirt. We were out walking the other night, and it was a full moon, and it was a big, bright, like, it was like a spotlight up there. I mean, it was so bright, and I'm going, shine a flashlight on dirt. You're not going to get that.
Uh-huh.
You know, like, it was lighting up everything. I mean, this was a big bright spotlight up there. And I'm going, how could we believe, and furthermore, how can we believe that we're reflecting off the red dirt of Mars and seeing it as a glowing star, you know, or any of the other
right.
so-called mm-hmm. planets for that matter? You know, if they're all reflective dirt and gas, how do we believe that?
Mm-hmm.
Now, well, I understand to some degree why we believe it, because if you spend any time looking through a telescope, the moon, it does look like, you know, the way the shadows are working on the in the craters and the mountains and what have you, that it does look like it's receiving light, you know, in terms of the way the shadows work. And yeah, I'll be honest, I don't totally understand how that works. If it's a self-illuminating orb, how are we getting the shadows that we're getting? I don't have the answer to that.
Yeah, I don't either, but I have read in several really cryptic passages of these two objects that are said to be clouds in some manner, and that they are what creates the phases of the moon. How that works, I don't know, but we do know that it is moving in 1/7 portion, that the light is reduced by 1/7 portion, and that, you know, as we see here in this portion of the Book of Enoch, it does describe the new moon as being equated with the waxing crescent, and it does attribute the dimensions of both the sun and the moon to be similar.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, these are all things to really consider, especially when you see the phenomena of the solar eclipse. And I'm not, you know, saying that that is caused even by the moon, because certainly the way that the eclipse played out this past year, it was a perfectly smooth circle. And then we know that, you know, there's things like the lesser moon spoken about mm-hmm. in the Book of Enoch, the Rahu Ketu in the Vedic cosmogony, and how, you know, the moon has these craters or these ridges, and it doesn't seem to be as perfectly as smooth as what we saw the shadow eclipsing the sun. And so it makes you wonder.
Yeah, you know, I have more questions even to this day than I have answers, and I'm actually okay with that.
Yeah, like, I am too.
And mm-hmm. back in 2015, I wasn't so okay with it. 15 and 16, I had all the yeah but questions everybody has, and I wanted to solve all the problems and figure out, well, how does this work? How does that work? You know, finally, I just said, you know what? I'm out of my wheelhouse. I've been out of my wheelhouse for a long time. I know what I'm good at. I know what I know, and I know what I don't know. And I know what I'm not going to figure out. So I'm good with it. Let someone else figure it out. I don't know how that works. All I know is what we're seeing is not what we've been taught. And that goes for everything.
Mm-hmm.
I posted a video a couple days ago by a woman doctor physician here in Dallas that spoke over the weekend talking about how, you know, the whole protocol for COVID-19 and everything is just a fraud. And, you know, she was like, I forget the name of it now, basically the malaria medicine that, you know, she brings patients come in and she gives them that, what is it? I forget the name of it. Anyway, that it,
Respirdil or something like that.
No, it's I'm thinking chloro.
The malaria stuff?
Chloro something other. Yeah. It starts with a C, I think. But anyway, whatever it is.
Okay. Yeah.
It you know, she's having people 100% cured within 24 to 48 hours.
Wow.
And she's like, you know, forget all this crap that they're trying to put out. You know, this is, and you know, you just kind of step back and think about everything that's coming from the media. I've been watching the miniseries on Netflix, Waco. Have you seen that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have.
And like, because the TV series is based on two novels, one by the guy, Thibodeau, who was actually one of the people who survived, who survived Waco. So, it, you know, that book's from his perspective inside the compound, and the other book that it's based on is from the negotiator, the FBI guy that was trying to, you know, save everybody and trying to, you know, work this out peacefully, and so he was seeing what was going on from his side. So, you know, the TV series, you know, if we're to assume that they're honest with it, and it looks like all the people involved included those writers, so it has authenticity to it, then and if we can assume that that TV series is, in fact, telling the truth, then you see how the media was manipulated, and as a result, the nation was manipulated. Like, for instance, they needed milk because the women were no longer lactating because of the stress and everything that was going on, so they were trying to negotiate to get milk in there, and the FBI is like, okay, well, send out four children, and we'll give you milk for the babies. And they're like, okay, so you want us to sacrifice some of our existing children to save, you know, our babies? Like, no. That doesn't make sense. Why would we do that, you know? And then you see how the FBI guy gets on TV and spins the narrative for the media, right. And how everybody believes it. And I'm like, this is a microcosm. If you just watch Waco and see how we are easily manipulated with simple untruths. And then extrapolate that to everything else, you know? And it's so easy to see how we have been deceived about anything. You know, mm-hmm. You always hear, it's too big a conspiracy. No, it isn't. There was the sort of a documentary style. It was a movie made to look like a documentary as if it was shot in the 60s called Operation Avalanche. And that movie was designed to look like it was shot live as things were happening, documenting the space program, the early Apollo program. And when they realized that we can't go to the moon, and that it's going to have to be a fraud, a staged event. And so one of the characters is like, well, how are we going to convince the American public, you know, that this is real? And one of the guys is such a genius line. It's so potent. It's so powerful. He said, we don't need to convince everybody. All we need to do is convince Walter Cronkite.
Right, right.
Because if he's convinced, see, the whole nation trusts him.
Right.
He's the face on the news that everybody loves and trusts. So if he believes it, if he buys into this hook, line, and sinker, and it doesn't mean he's in on it. It means he's deceived.
Right, and he'll sell everybody else.
He will sell his reaction to what is happening, will sell it to everybody else. So the whole world could easily be programmed by the reaction of one guy being deceived. And then sort of by contrast, we could see how the whole nation could be deceived by one guy lying. In this case, the FBI, you know, the main contact guy with the media, by his story of twisting the events, gets the whole, you know, I think David Koresh's theology was way off. You know, I'm certainly not endorsing it. But the reality is they weren't hurting anybody.
Right.
You know, we would consider him a false prophet, and people were being deceived by him. I get that.
Yeah.
That's no reason to kill women and children and burn places down with people in it and, you know, shoot people up. Just, you know. So, you know, I just look around at everything from moon landing to cosmology to COVID-19 to you name it and going, man, we're being lied to about every freaking thing out there.
Right.
And it's
absolutely
easy to be deceived.
Mm-hmm. Have you, speaking of Waco, have you seen the infrared footage that was shot from above?
No.
Oh my gosh. This is where you get the real story, because it shows, the heat signatures of the individuals and the tanks, and you know, the tank that was spraying all that CS gas, and how it was literally running over people, and they sprayed all the gas into the faces of all these women and children, and anybody that was trying to exit out, you could see that they had guys with machine guns surrounding the house, and they were just shooting people, and so there was no way for them to be able to exit. And you can see all the gunfire, and it is horrible, because it was a massacre. It was a straight up massacre, and it was something that they wanted to establish, because now, you know, with the Patriot Act, you have Christians and patriots targeted. And they want to be able to use the alternative military tribunal system to declare somebody as a domestic terrorist and then strip away their habeas corpus rights, you know, and then they can put them into this alternative system. But the whole thing of cracking down on Ruby Ridge and Waco, is to demonize Christians that believed in their Second Amendment rights and that gathered together in communions or congregations where, you know, they were supporting each other with, you know, the biblical theologies and faith and traditions of that nature, which again, I'm not at all endorsing Koresh, and you know, especially if he was a pedophile, which everybody seems to agree that, you know, he was marrying multiple wives and fathering children by other men's wives, and so that's all really kind of strange and twisted as well. But still, to be to declare, you know, Christians and just for having guns as militants or terrorists, and then to go in and manipulating the media and to massacre them in fire, and not only, I mean, they were shooting them with gunfire, machine gun fire, and then they sprayed that CS gas, which killed many of them. I mean, it's horrible. And I'll try to find, because this is footage, I wish I would have saved it a long time ago, but and I did, but some of the, you know, some of the old external hard drives that I have are not up to snuff anymore because of how old they were and then the connections and everything being different. But I can't access that footage now, but I'm going to try to find it. And if people don't know what I'm talking about, they should watch the infrared footage because it tells the truth of the story.
It's so horrible. But, you know,
it really is.
All of that to say, what I have become, like, keenly aware of is just how easy it is to be deceived.
Yes.
And, you know, you don't know when you're being deceived. That's the whole, you know, the reason why we say you're deceived. You know, right? You don't go into it and say, hey, you know what? I think I'm going to believe a lie today.
Right.
You know? Samuel Clemens or whatever, Mark Twain said something about it's easier to deceive a man than it is to convince a man that he is deceived or something like that.
Yeah, I don't know
the exact quote, but you get the idea.
Right.
That's certainly the case, and that's why, you know, I keep, even though I don't understand things, and even though things, frankly, still make sense to me, some things make sense to me on the globe, I've just seen too much in the world for me to ever accept the world's explanation as the truth. And I'm like, you know what, Father? That's when I finally just had to yield and say, you know what? I have never had a reason to doubt your word. So I'm going to just take a stand on it. It says what it says. You said that's all he would ever say to me. He's like, look, I said what I said. You know, take it or leave it. I'm going to believe it. And Enoch just solidifies it all the more for me.
Yes, absolutely agree. And you know, like Capricorn 1, I mean,
great movie.
They seem to have known something going back to those times, and these kind of documentaries being made that show, and without a doubt, I mean, they did not go to the moon. And for people that still believe and support that whole lie, that in and of itself shows just how much and how they were able to deceive the whole world even back then, to where they actually had us believe that the astronauts on the moon took a call from Richard Nixon.
Right.
You know? I mean,
really?
Come on.
That's when they were really pushing it. It's like,
right,
this is the best phone call we've ever had, you know, and whatever. He's talking like, whatever. You're talking to the freaking moon. You know, now we believe we're controlling dune buggies, you know, on freaking Mars.
Right.
By remote control. It's like, come on, man.
Right.
So, anyway, back to the narrative. It is interesting. It shows that light's being transferred. Now, if you go back to what I was telling people about the Thunderbolts project, I don't know it well enough to articulate it, so I would just say, hey, go on there and check it out. They probably got some stuff in their playlist and whatever on that. But showing, if we think of an electroplasma universe where things are exchanging energy, all the more so, and this is why Bob Nodell got excited about it, because, you know, he understands all that a lot more than I do as an engineer, like how the firmament would work, you know, for completing circuits and, you know, all that kind of stuff. When you start talking about electricity, magnetism, plasma, and all that kind of stuff, and factoring in, you know, a cosmos that's designed that way, and if gravity being more having to do with electromagnetism, which in the 1920s they had already figured that out. You know, I've talked about I talked about Townsend Brown in the book Hunt for Zero Point. That's a great book people need to check out. You know, because they had created anti-gravitics in the 1920s, anti-gravity.
And yeah, that's amazing.
They did it with you know, reversing polarity and stuff with the electrogravitics. You know, so it has nothing to do with, you know, mass and attraction the way the Newton-Einstein kind of concept of gravity that we have today. Like, somebody got on to me, I was saying, hey, gravity works, right? You know, with regard to raising a rain barrel up above your garden. So if the water's higher, gravity will, you know, feed the water into the rest of the garden. And they're like, oh, I thought you were a flat earther. You don't believe in gravity. Look, that's just the word that we use to describe that which holds us down.
Right, right.
And the fact is, nobody knows what gravity is. We use the word because we have to have a word to describe something. You know, why don't we fly in the air? Well, because gravity. But they even say we don't know what gravity is. Neil deGrasse Tyson and those guys.
We'll be right back, everyone, for final segment.
The reviews for Extendivite are amazing. Here are some from Amazon. September 2018. Extendivite works in keeping my blood pressure in the normal range. I've been using Extendivite for many years now. May 2018. Great product. I use regularly and I rarely get sick. March 2018. This product has relieved what appeared to be angina pain in my chest and shortness of breath after climbing stairs. I'm quite happy about it. February 2018. My husband, son, and I have been using this product for a few months now, and we have noticed an improvement in our joints and blood pressure. Tell us your story. Get Extendivite today. To order, call 1-877-928-8822. That's 1-877-928-8822 or visit heartdrop.com.
Extend your life with Extendivite.
Balance of Nature's fruits and veggies in a capsule.
It's a great product. And the one thing I like about it the most is that when you open the bottles, you can smell like the scent of the fruits and veggies. It's no genius thing to it. It's really just fruits and veggies, which everyone needs. And they kind of, you guys kind of put it in a way where you can take it easy and you can get it and it's natural. And that's what I like about it. Yeah. I like the product and, I've taken it, and it's definitely made me feel a lot better. You know, I am a healthy person to begin with, but it's definitely good prevention, and it's definitely gives me energy, and I feel like it's a natural thing. I like it. I really do.
For a limited time, use discount code TALK to receive a 50% discount on your first preferred whole health system and have it shipped to you free. Call 1-800-246-8751 or go online to balanceofnature.com. Again, use discount code TALK.
For millennia, mankind has been searching for answers to the big questions, such as, where did the universe come from? Where did we come from? Why are we here? Are we alone? And just what the heck is the Sasquatch all about? I can't promise you answers and neither can the Woo Crew, but they invite you to join them Friday night at 7 p.m. Eastern, midnight in the UK, for Freaky Friday, exclusively on Truth Frequency Radio. Spirituality, multiverse, quantum mechanics, the occult, and so much conspiracy analysis that it will make your mind melt. Take my word for it. Freaky Friday. It's more than a show. It's a way of life. I'm Stephen Hawking, and I'm proud to be a Wookiee.
This is Truth Frequency Radio.
No hate, no hype, no fear. Real people, real radio.
All right, welcome back, everybody, for final segment. The show does move so very quickly. I think I may have found the actual what is the FLIR, the infrared footage, but I'm not positive. But I will post a link in the chat room for people that may be interested. If it's the same one that I've seen previously, it shows you the infrared, the footage, where you can see the compound surrounded and the gunfire and then the tank going in and spraying the CS gas and all that. It's just, it's horrible, it's tragic, but there's no way that they can deny that it was a massacre if you watch this footage, if it's what I had seen previously. But don't want to detract. I know that, you know, we need to move through this particular book and text as well, but is there anything else you wanted to bring up on this particular chapter?
Yeah, there was something I'm trying to find it where it went, that talked about it has the face of a man.
Right, the very last sentence.
Oh yeah. let me share that there. In the night it appears for each 20 days as the face of a man, and in the day as heaven, for it is nothing except its own light. That's kind of bizarre.
Yeah, and the only thing I could think with regard to that is the way that the moon in the profile, that it might look like, you know, how they sometimes depict the crescent as the face or as a face.
Well, yeah, we've had that idiom, you know, the man in the moon.
Yeah, for a long time, right?
For forever, it seems like, you know, every culture seems to have that sort of, you know, understanding. You know, I've looked at the thing, and I don't see it. I mean, I don't see the nose.
Right, yeah.
You know, you always see the pictures of the crescent moon with the nose, and it's got a little face on it, you know.
Right.
Or when you're looking at the... they call them the seas on the moon, you know, the like Sea of Tranquility and whatnot.
The Maris.
Yeah, the Maris. How they look like, or supposedly look like a face of a man. And I look, it looks like a rabbit to me. I'm not getting it. You know, maybe, you know, I'm 50, so it took me 5 years to get the circle thing, right? Maybe it's taking me, I still don't get the man in the moon thing.
Yeah, maybe another 5 years we'll revisit it.
Maybe we'll find out. It's bizarre. I never seen that. It says that here in Enoch too, though. Well, actually, in Charles, it says, "At night she appears like a man." And then Lawrence says the face. Well, it's in the italics, so Lawrence inserted that as the face of a man. So that's interesting. Oh well. did you want to just jump into to the next one?
Yeah, let's move on, because it's after this, the dream vision, so maybe we'll have a perfect setup for next week.
All right, so Lawrence, what is this, 78? And now, my son Methuselah, I have shown thee everything, and the account of every ordinance of the stars of heaven is finished. He showed me every ordinance respecting these, which takes place at all times and in all seasons, under every influence, in all years, at the arrival and under the rule of each, during each month and every week. He showed me also the decrees of the moon, which is affected in the sixth gate, for in the sixth gate is its light consumed. From this is the beginning of the month, and its decrease is affected in the sixth gate in its period until 177 days are completed, according to the mode of computation by weeks, 25 weeks and 2 days. Its period is less than that of the sun, according to the ordinance of the stars, by 5 days in 1/2 year precisely. When that their visible situation is completed, such is the appearance and likeness of every luminary, which Thiel, oh, that's a new angel here, the angel who conducts them, showed me. That's the first time I heard of that guy.
All right. And now, my son, I have shown thee everything, and the law of all the stars of the heaven is completed. And he showed me all the laws of these for every day, and for every season of bearing rule, and for every year, and for its going forth, and for the order prescribed to it every month and every week, and the waning of the moon, which takes place in the sixth portal. For in this sixth portal her light is accomplished, and after that there is the beginning of the waning, and the waning which takes place in the first portal in its season, till 177 days are accomplished, reckoned according to weeks, 25 weeks and 2 days. She falls behind the sun in the order of the stars exactly 5 days in the course of one period. And when this place which thou seest has been traversed, such is the picture and sketch of every luminary which Uriel the archangel, who is their leader, showed unto me.
Oh, so it's saying Uriel, or Uriel in the Charles translation. In the
yes
Lawrence, it says Thiel. Well, let me look it up in the. That's why it's like all these things always have multiple translations to compare, because whenever you see a difference, mm-hmm. it's like, oh, what is that all about? What chapter is this? 77?
79 in the Charles. 78 for you, I think.
Except it's light. URL. Yeah, it says URL, so I guess you know, Lawrence, maybe that could be a typo. I also meant to talk about something earlier. The Ebla tablets is something I looked up.
Right.
But that's not named after the... Well, it's named after a city in Syria, I believe. Let me look. The Ebla tablets are a collection of as many as 1,800 complete clay tablets, 4,700 fragments, and many thousands of minor chips found in the palace archives of the ancient city of Ebla, Syria. I remember looking into this a while back because it stirred up a bit of a controversy. Like, you know, is Genesis a myth? Is Genesis just copying? You know, and different things like that. That old line. But the idea that a place in Syria is named after a name of the moon is kind of interesting, because when I was doing my Yahuwah Triangle research, you know, Abraham was called out of Ur of the Chaldees, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he was told to leave his family and go by himself. But he didn't. He took his dad and his uncle, I think, with him.
Uh-huh.
And they went from where did they go? From Ur to
Haran.
Haran, yeah. And Haran was the name, because there was a whole fiery furnace deal where Abraham was thrown into a fiery furnace and
right by Nimrod.
Yeah, and his brother. One of his brothers, I think, or
Nahor.
Yeah, Haran died. I think it was Haran. One of them died, and so the place Haran was named after him.
Ah, okay.
But what I was reading is that, because we know both from the canonized texts as well as extra biblical texts like Joshua, that Abraham's father Terah was an idol worshiper, uh-huh. and he was in fact the chief idol maker.
for Nimrod. And the chief priest.
Yeah, for Nimrod. For Nimrod. And like his primary base of operation was in Ur, but he had a secondary place, which was in Haran. So, you know, he just went from one idol place to another. And that's when God said, look, I told you, you get out of there, you leave your dad, you're going to Canaan, right? But the patron god of Haran, I believe it was a moon god named Sin.
Right.
So it's like, you know, he's called out of Sin, you know, to go to the land that God had called him to. But anyway, this whole idea of moon worship in that region. So the idea that there'd be a name of the moon being Ebla, also being the name of a city, that really makes sense, contextually speaking.
Yep. And the Muslims seem to be, and you know, even going back to, as you said, this god Sin, that being part of the moon god, that it's still the, you know, you see the crescent on top of all the a lot of the mosques, and even on their flags, and so in similarity, that same, the worship of this particular deity is ongoing even today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. Did you have any thoughts of what we were reading here in this passage?
I do have an explanation out of all that from my book. I'll just read that really quickly, and then we'll move on. And these are the numbers that are being spoken about here. The calculation of a lunar year can be determined by multiplying 29 days by 6 months and 30 days by 6 months, and then adding these two numbers together, 29 by 6, 174, 30 by 6, equals 180. So 174 and 180 equals 354, the total number of days of a lunar year. The calculation of a solar year can be determined by multiplying 30 days by 12 months and then adding the 4 days for the two equinoxes and solstices, giving us 364, the total number of days of a solar year. Subtracting the number of days of a solar year, 364, from the number of days of a lunar year, 354, equals 10, the number of days of difference between these two yearly cycles. Dividing the 10 days by one half for each of the 6 month periods, you have 5 days and one half year precisely, which is the number of days that each half of the lunar year is less than the total number of days of every half of a solar year. And so this is what Enoch is talking about and describing, this particular portion of the text. But yeah, we can move on. I think we can finish this out.
So this would be 80?
80 for me.
Okay, for you.
So maybe 79 for you.
Yeah, 79. Okay. In those days, Uriel answered and said to me, "Behold, I have showed thee all things, O Enoch, and all things have I revealed to thee. Thou seest the sun, the moon, and those which conduct the stars of heaven, which cause all their operations, seasons, and arrivals to return. In the days of sinners, the years shall be shortened. Their seed shall be backward in their prolific soil, and everything done on earth shall be subverted and disappear in its season. The rain shall be restrained, and heaven shall stand still. In those days the fruits of the earth shall be late and not flourish in their season, and in their season the fruits of the trees shall be withholden." See, I don't have a black thumb. It's all been prophesied. Plants aren't going to grow.
Prophesied, right?
No, I'm not going to confess that. The moon shall change its laws and not be seen at its proper period. Now, this is interesting to me. The moon shall change its laws and not be seen in its proper period. But in those days shall heaven be seen, and barrenness shall take place in the borders of the great chariots in the west. Heaven shall shine more than when illuminated by the orders of light, while many chiefs among the stars of authority shall err, perverting their ways and works. Those shall not appear in their season who command them, and all the classes of the stars shall be shut up against sinners. The thoughts of those who dwell on earth shall transgress with them, and they shall be perverted in all their ways, and they shall transgress and think themselves gods, while evil shall be multiplied among them, and punishment shall come upon them, so that all of them shall be destroyed. I know that Charles clears that up a bit, so go ahead and jump into the Charles.
Okay. Chapter 80. And in those days the angel Uriel answered and said to me, "Behold, I have shown thee everything, Enoch, and I have revealed everything to thee, that thou shouldst see this sun and this moon, and the leaders of the stars of heaven, and all those who turn them, their tasks and times and departures. And in the days of the sinners the years shall be shortened, and their seed shall be tardy on their lands and fields. And all things on the earth shall alter, and shall not appear in their time, and the rain shall be kept back, and the heaven shall withhold it. And in those times the fruits of the earth shall be backward, and shall not grow in their time, and the fruits of the trees shall be withheld in their time, and the moon shall alter her order, and not appear at her time. And in those days the sun shall be seen, and he shall journey in the evening on the extremity of the great chariot in the west, and shall shine more brightly than accords with the order of light. And many chiefs of the stars shall transgress the order prescribed, and these shall alter their orbits and tasks, and not appear at the seasons prescribed to them. And the whole order of the stars shall be concealed from the sinners, and the thoughts of those on the earth shall err concerning them, and they shall be altered from their ways. Yea, they shall err and take them to be gods, and evil shall be multiplied upon them, and punishment shall come upon them, so as to destroy all."
Wow, that, there's a lot going on here. Interesting. Mm-hmm. You know, it starts off saying, in the days of the sinners, the years shall be shortened. You know, Yeshua said, except those days be shortened, no flesh would be saved.
Right, yes.
So there's an internal reference right there, almost verbatim. So we have a situation where the produce of the earth is altered. It's not coming forth when it's supposed to. The moon shall alter her order. See, this is where I think in the last days people are going to be without excuse. If I'm not mistaken, I'm not sure I got the address right, but I believe it's Revelation 14 maybe, where Yahuwah sends out an angel to proclaim the gospel to all the world.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we as humans have the great commission to be doing that, and we should be doing that. But there's going to be an angel that's going to go forth and do it. So everybody's going to hear it. You know, so you're not going to have the argument, well, what about deepest, darkest Africa where they've never heard a missionary or whatever? Like, it's going to go out. Everybody's going to hear it.
Right.
Now, whether that occurs before, during, or after what we're reading here, that I don't know. But, there, you know, Yeshua said there's going to be signs in the sun, in the moon, and the stars.
Right. Yes.
So he said that. So, again, that's a callback to Enoch, because Enoch tells you what the signs are going to be.
Right, exactly, yes.
Because, you know, if you just read the, you know, Matthew 24, Luke 21 passage, that's a vague. What does that mean? Signs in the sun, the moon, what are the signs? What are we going to see? You know, Enoch's telling you, well, it's not going to show up when it's supposed to, and things are going to do different things.
Yes.
Stars are going to start moving around and doing stuff. I've seen some things myself where I was, you know, just laying out, you know, nice, cool night, looking up at the stars, and all of a sudden, you know, what I would consider a little constellation of stars all of a sudden start moving and doing stuff. You know, it was sitting there doing its thing for a while, and then it starts moving. Like, what? I've seen some weird stuff. Rick Hummer called me freaking out. I haven't called him and talked to him about it yet, but he was doing the same thing. He said just the other day he just went outside, just go up and look at the sky, and he's like, dude, like, I've seen some really weird stuff, man. Things are happening up there. You know, more and more people are going to see stuff like that, but that's going
to... Yeah, I agree.
That's going to increase. In those days, the sun shall be seen... Okay, the moon shall alter her order and not appear at a time. So the moon is not going to pop up when it's supposed to. In those days, the sun shall be seen, and he shall journey in the evening on the extremity of the great chariot in the west, and shall shine more brightly than accords with the order of light. So that's going to flip everybody up. So Copernican model is going to go out the window one way or another. So hang on, hang on, flat earthers. Your day's coming when everybody that's making fun of you is going to be like, what? Something's going on here. Because, you know, for the Copernican model, for anything that we're seeing here to actually happen, that would require altering of the Earth's rotation and orbit, you know. But for the geocentrists, they'll be like, okay, well, you know, that's weird. Something's going on. You know, the Earth is stationary in their view. and in the biblical worldview that you and I have, you know, we recognize the sun, moon, and stars are up there doing their thing over a stationary flat Earth. So, yes. You know, I think I've told you before, and I've mentioned it certainly on a number of shows before, that I had it was more than a dream, man. It was like a very powerful, like I was there kind of open vision type of thing where I was at the end of Lake Louisville. Is a large reservoir near where I live. It's about 7 miles across. I was doing some long distance photography there, you know, testing the globe. And I was underneath an overpass bridge where the shoreline was. And I heard this loud, like massive boom sound. It was in the middle of the afternoon. And I was doing my tests and this loud boom and the sun shut off.
Like
it's just like poof. The sun was up high in the sky, clear day. It just shut off.
Wow.
And it was a blacker black darkness than anything that I've ever encountered in my life. Like you could put your hand right in front of your face and couldn't see it. You know?
Like the crucifixion.
Yeah. And like in the Exodus.
3 hours of darkness. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, when I look at this passage here, you know, the sun, moon, and stars are going to start doing weird stuff. You know, I'm going, oh boy. And the whole order of the stars shall be concealed from the sinners, and the thoughts of those on earth shall err concerning them. Concerning them. What's the them there? The antecedent is the stars. So they'll be altered in their ways, and people shall err. They shall err and take them to be gods. And I just posted something about this on Facebook the other day, saying, look, you know, there's a reason the ancients looked at those as sentient beings. And Mars, we named the so-called wandering planets after sentient beings. You know,
yes.
Jupiter, Zeus, you know, that's right. the Roman version of the Greek Zeus. You know, Mars is Aries and so forth. You know, and you got to realize in the biblical times, King Wells has a book called Ancient Myths and the Bible. And in the book, he's talking about how we should understand the Bible from a mythological worldview. Now, he's not saying we should write the Bible off as mythology. What he means by that is, look, you need to understand that what we now call myth, the people in the Bible were living in a day when they believed it as truth.
Right.
It's so much so that they thought Paul was the Mercury, the messenger of the God, and Barnabas was Zeus.
Right.
Like, you know.
With the miracles they were accomplishing,
Yeah, you know, and because Paul is a spokesperson, they felt like, well, he's a spokesperson of the God, so he must be Mercury, right? So,
yeah, right.
You know, and they talk about Diana of the Ephesians and stuff, how they, you know, she fell from Jupiter, and, you know, that there was an understanding that there was a being that came down from the skies that started out as what you perceive as we would consider a star and walked among men as a sentient being. And Enoch's telling you that's going to happen again. That's why the ancient aliens crowd is. This is why I firmly believe the devil's had a plan.
Oh, no doubt, yeah.
That he's setting us up for, which is why we've had, 12, 13, 14 seasons, or whatever it is, of ancient aliens out there programming people so that when this stuff starts happening, that's what they're going to believe.
Yeah, absolutely. And so many people are going to be ripe for accepting that, you know, because, again, the whole strong delusion and they have no love of the truth. And that they will be swept away, caught up in this strong delusion sent by God.
Yeah, we're interested. We're in for some interesting days ahead, man.
Right.
You know, how far off?
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know, but, you know, with what's happening in the world right now, I'll tell you, my timeline is truncated. You know, it's you know, I'll die of old age before Christ returns. That's what I was saying, like, 4 months ago, 5 months ago. Mm-hmm. Now go, well, I don't know.
My, how things quickly change, huh?
Well, the days shall be shortened, so everything certainly seems to be ramping up, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, and that reminds me that you were talking about the conference coming up this weekend as well. What was that again?
True Legends conference.
Because, the Steve Quayle Genesis 6 one, right?
Yeah, thanks for reminding me. I think that starts tomorrow, I think.
Yeah, I need to actually.
Yeah, I do too. Right after this, after we get off the air, I might as well get on there
right. and do it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think I'll do the same. But and so we should be moving on pretty soon into the dream vision now that we've finished what Enoch relates or receives from Uriel and then relates to his son Methuselah. And so that will be very exciting. A few chapters as well, because all that is prophetic.
Oh yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Looking forward to the animal apocalypse dream.
Yeah, the animal farm.
The animal farm.
yeah,
definitely interesting. I've got it up on the screen for people that want to check out that same conference. It's Gen 6 Productions and the True Legends Conference.
All right. Well, excellent, brother. Well, it was a great show always, and. Looking forward to further discussions. Do you have any other guests that are coming on?
That's interesting. I talked with a guy today that may be a really good guest for me to do. Next week, you're going to be on my show on Wednesday, mm-hmm. so it'll be the week after, talking about social programming and how that works. And had about an hour-long conversation with this guy today. Really interesting stuff. So. He's choosing to remain anonymous for reasons that I totally get. So we may stage him up like Guy Fawkes or something, and do him like a QAnon kind of looking guy, something like that. But just to kind of protect his identity. But interesting stuff.
Uh-huh. Speaking of which, I just did a show with a friend named Aaron Moffitt who has been following that whole QAnon for a very long time.
Yeah,
and she's now. Coming out of it a little bit, and so that was a very interesting show.
Yeah.
People can check that out.
Yeah, I remain, by the way, the Q in the background, it has nothing to do with Q. It's Quest4Truth in our logo. But I'm skeptical about all that. But great show, man.
Yeah, great show, brother. Send our regards to the family. Be blessed, everyone. Good night.
Good night, everybody.